necessarily a big supply at the moment, any of those things, but the general conclusion is the story is not over yet, which I guess if you're 250 years old, that's a pretty good lesson. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Stephanie, and all the panelists for this very interesting and open discussion. You all emphasized the importance of public trust, and we have heard that three of the most important central banks in the world are committed to better communication with the public, which would make many people in my department very happy. Okay, so now finally, I give the word to one of our hosts, Governor Stephanie.
The ambitious theme for this conference has been the past, the present, and the future of central banking. There were many intriguing observations on this also in the Nordic session, as I call it, before lunch. And we have been treated to many further insights during this afternoon and during what I could call the international session. So also my congratulations editors of and the contributors to the commemorative book on the history of central banking. Good job, very well done. And let me also thank my esteemed colleagues in this afternoon's panel and also our moderator, Ms. Flanders, for sharing their views on the future of central banking. Now, today we have in effect covered a period stretching from 1668 until the present day, and also actually a bit beyond. And to sum up the main conclusions from all the presentations and discussions on those 350 plus years in 15 minutes, that would be just too much. So in these concluding remarks, my more modest aim is to draw inspiration from today's discussion and say a few words on what I see as some of the general challenges for the Riksbank moving forward, adapting to a changing environment, and adjusting to its role in the economy. Now, as you have seen today, central banking experiences differ over time. And you don't have to go very far back in history to realize that. Just prior to the change to a floating exchange rate and inflation targeting framework in 1992 and 1993, the Riksbank looked very different from today. The flagship of the organization was the trading room, with the responsibility of maintaining the exchange rate stable. The majority of the 750-some employees of the bank worked with the manufacturing and distribution of cash. Today, the Riksbank's involvement in cash management is down to a bare minimum, and the organization is much slimmer. There are now around 320 employees, and close to half of them are involved with monetary policy and financial stability in one form or the other, two policy areas that only a very few directly were concerned with just 30 years ago. So what the Riksbank does and how it does it is certainly different today than it was in the 80s. But the fundamental functions the bank is performing, the underlying reasons why the Riksbank does what it does, have not really changed all that much. Actually, let's imagine that we had been able to bring representatives of the Riksbank from all of the previous centuries to join this 350-year birthday celebration. What would they think about the organization? Well, depending on their century of origin, they would obviously struggle with different features, different words, and different concepts. For one thing, our colleagues from the 17th and 18th century would be unfamiliar with the very term central bank. The representatives from the 1800s would likely be appalled by the lack of decorum in today's Riksbank. Just imagine a governor of the bank appearing out of uniform. What would that look like? And all, including the people from the early 1900s, would be amazed to hear that half of the management positions in the bank are presently held by women. Now, but these things, these kinds of things aside, I imagine that all our time-traveling guests would be nodding in recognition if you told them that the fundamental role of the Riksbank is to lay the foundation for a smoothly functioning trade in goods and services by making sure that there is a stable and efficient payment system and that there is confidence in the usability and the value of the means of payment. But in order to meet these objectives, it has been and will continue to be necessary for the Riksbank and other central banks also, of course, to adjust day-to-day operations and organizational frameworks to new challenges as the economy and as society in general evolve. In other words, to change what we do and how we do it. Now, there's probably no more striking example of this right now than the rapidly declining demand for banknotes and coins and the question of what this implies for the Riksbank. Since 2008, the demand for cash has declined by around 40% in this country. Today, 15% of payments in the retail trade are made in cash, a number that was around 40% not even 10 years ago. Internationally, this is unique. But the increasing popularity of digital payment solutions is a global trend, and more countries probably be in a similar situation fairly soon. What would it mean, what would it actually mean if cash disappears from the economy? Well, the general public, unlike the banks, would no longer have access to money issued by the central bank. In other words, they would no longer be able to eat notes and coins without creditors issued by a government body tasked with maintaining the long-term value of money. The public would only have access to account-based private bank money. Would this be a problem? Well, during normal times, probably not. But what happens when there is a financial stress, which history tells us happens from time to time? This goes straight to the core of the Riksbank's objectives. So it's not surprising then that we feel it is important to investigate this further. Have the arguments for providing the general public with assets and means of payments for your credit risks actually lost their significance? Do Swedes in general no longer see the need for central bank money? Or is it rather that they don't want to keep physical notes? If that is the case, I believe the Riksbank has a duty to look into the scope for issuing an e-krona, a digital alternative to the traditional krona made from either pieces of cotton or metal. By the way, and others have alluded to that earlier today, our Riksbank guests from the late 1800s could probably join this discussion with surprising ease. The basic questions are the same that they debated over a century ago, which back then resulted in the Riksbank's monopoly on issuing banknotes in 1904. Now, the rapid decline in the use of cash in this country is, of course, part of a broader digitalization trend that affects all parts of society. And the implications of this trend do not restrict themselves to the Riksbank's role in the management of cash and our large value payment system. Basically, all policy areas and every part of the bank the Riksbank communicates with the general public and the way we organize ourselves and work within the bank. Another trend with far-reaching implications is the growing interdependence between economies on a global scale. The rapid increase in cross-border movements of goods, services, and capital creates benefits. But it also means that the effects of shocks as well as policies are transmitted across borders to an increasing extent. This presents challenges for all policy areas of a central bank, and particularly in a small open economy, monetary policy will, for example, need to deal with the fact that asset prices and the exchange rate are increasingly influenced by monetary policy in the major currency areas. Now, another example of the challenges with expanding financial linkages is the fall in real interest rates that has taken place around the world. This is a feature that most likely will continue to shape the economic landscape for some time to come, and it entails a number of challenging questions. And some of them others have touched on in the afternoon. Do our monetary policy frameworks need to adapt to the fact that there is less scope to cut policy rates when interest rates are low on average? Now, since this environment tends to trigger increasing indebtedness, what are then the implications for financial stability? How much attention should monetary policy give to financial stability? Questions that we have heard a lot about in the course of the day. In general, what instruments should central banks use to promote financial stability? And importantly, if our mandate changes, what demands are then placed on central bank accountability and transparency? Now, from the discussions today, it has been reassuring to see that these questions are also being pondered by many colleagues around the world. At the Riksbank, we hope to learn from all of you and your experience and insights and continue cooperating with you on many of these issues. So thank you for that. And then, because this could have been the end of my speech, let me say, oh, there's one more thing, and this is to quote the late great Steve Jobs, the man who really had the ability to change the future. First of all, let me say a heartfelt thank you to the Swedish Parliament, Riksdagen, for our birthday present. So thank you very much for that. And finally, this fantastic conference, and in fact, the whole 350-year celebration with all its activities would not be possible without well-organized and careful planning. So therefore, and on behalf of my other colleagues on the executive board and the general counsel, our humble thanks to the team behind this day and the ongoing evening that will ensue. And a special thanks to Åsa Söder-Nilsson, Maria Svalfors, and Tommy Persson. And also many, many others, our staff at the Riksbank. Because without their diligent work for quite some time, it would not have been possible to frame this day and the coming. Thank you all.
Thank you, Stefan, and thanks to all the speakers, panelists, and the moderators, and not least to our host, the Riksdag. We will meet again in 1.5 hour for dinner in the City Hall, and this is the last time you will hear today. Don't forget to pick up these entry cards if you haven't done so already. See you in 1.5 hour.